Hello, I'm Stephen Berry, Escambia County Commissioner, District 5. Thank you for taking the time to tune in. Today, I'm going to be introducing you to three groups that are each working very hard to make our community a better place to live. Each of the not-for-profits have different missions, but their outcomes are very similar. By working hard and working together, they're making District 5 a better place for all of us to live. First is the Miracle League of Northeast Pensacola. It's a league for special needs children and adults that's located in the northeast corner of John R. Jones Park. Tonight with me, my friend Packy Mitchell, who has been involved in the Miracle League since its inception and has been an integral part of hundreds of families and children being able to play baseball each and every year.
Well, Larry and Donna Thompson were actually our founders. They were parents and they lost a kid years ago at Tate, a baseball player. And we left the ball game one night at Tate, went to Friends Diner, which was a local dinner, a restaurant up there in Gonzales. I was sitting at a booth. They came in. I used to announce the games there. And they said, "Packy, we're going, did you see the story on the Miracle League on HBO? And I said, "Well, actually, I did." And they said, "Well, we're going to look into it. You know, we want to try to do something for Brad's memory." And I said, "Well, I'll help you any way I can." And that kind of started our relationship with it. And, you know, until Donna passed away this year, we were the only three founding board members that are still involved. But they're considered our founders. I joined with them then, and it's just been a group effort ever since, with many people coming on board, and some coming, some staying, some going, but been a great effort by the community. So we've grown from 36 players or something we had the first year we opened to almost 200 now, and want to continue to grow. And that's what we try to get in all the media, you know, the papers and TVs, and, you know, with your group and all. Now, you know, people, if you got kids out there that would qualify, bring them out. And we want to grow. We're fixing to build a third field. We're fixing to do an active money raising fundraiser and start really putting that out. And we want to put a third field in, and, you know, we want it to continue to grow. Any person with any type of disability, we've got them from probably 5 years old. I think we've got a fellow that's 62 years old. Miracle League initially said, "Hey, it's for not up to 19. We throwed that out as soon as we started. We had a lady, we were signing up one of our first years. A lady came up and she said, "Can I play?" And we all looked at each other and says, "Throw the 19 out, we're going to let her play." So it started like that and continues. In fact, it's a husband and wife, boyfriend and girlfriend, whatever they are. But anyway, they play, you know, and they're up in their 60s. You know, and we started maybe 5 or 6 years old. But any type of disability, we've got the garment. It makes my heart bleed. It's so wonderful. For 2 or 3 years, I'd stand at the fence with my sunglasses on, you know, because I still, and to this day, and before this interview's over with, it'll probably get me, because it gets to my heart that much, because we've seen some kids. We've got some that started out on small walkers that would not do anything at home. They'd bring them out here, and they'd start moving around and getting involved to the point of a few years ago, Riley gets out of the car, and he's walking, holding on to his mom. Well, I lost it, dude. I mean, it was like, you know, here it is. You know, this is, and they'll tell you, this is what it's all about. It helps them. Well, we start out, we play 6 weeks in the spring and 6 weeks in the fall. Depending on where it falls in Easter, we'll take Easter weekend off in the spring. We play Friday nights. Our older categories play. We got four teams that play on two fields on Friday nights, which is, winds up being eight teams. And then Saturday morning, we have eight teams play on. We have 16 total. They play on Saturday mornings. It's a typical ball game, home team, visitors, everybody bats, everybody runs the bases, and typically the last batter, if there's anybody on bases, they hit a home run whether they do or not. Clears the bases, everybody's cheering, and the good part about this thing is the kids all cheer for each other, you know, the fans, you know, everybody's cheering for each other. It's what baseball is all about, you know. I mean, we love the game, American sport, but out here, it'll show you what, it'll humble you. A typical parent that brings their kids out, it also gives them a luxury of an hour and a half of relaxing, enjoying themselves. You know, we've got some kids that bounce off the fences, you know. Well, that parent, say that's an hour and a half, they don't chase them. We have a great relationship with the Navy base, and we go pick up, I'll take the bus out on Fridays and Saturdays along with Steve Langham. We'll pick up 20 or 25 buddies from the Navy base. Well, one of those kids, it'll take two of them to chase him around all night, or her, whatever, usually a couple of boys we got that's pistols. But, you know, those parents can sit back and watch and relax and see it, and that stress is off of them for a while. So, I mean, I think it's wonderful for parents, too. We've had, you know, hundreds of buddies come out through the years, and I don't miss anybody, but the Navy base, Pensacola State College, the junior college, F. Davis, Tate High School has groups. We've had a couple of the baseball teams, Washington, Tate, West Florida Tech come out. And each time that they do, I know a lot of those people, and they'll come up to me and tell you they got more out of it than the kids did. And, you know, we've got some that continue to come every year. They've buddied with, we've had some that's buddied for 4 or 5 years with the same kid. So it means a lot to them. If you want to humble yourself and have a warm heart, you know, get involved, come out and see us. We won't start now until probably sometime in March, but it'll be advertised on our website. But come out on a Friday night or Saturday morning and see what baseball is all about. Well, when it starts out, we initially have to have asphalt under our surface. Panhandle Paving Grading did our first field. The Mills family did our first asphalt for us. Charles Heaton did our second asphalt for us. Great people, you know, just ask them and they come on board with us. The surface is a 2-inch rubberized, actually the old Firestone tires that was recycled years ago. It's a 2-inch octagon shaped surface that glues down, and underneath has pockets where water seep through and run on. The fields are put on a little taper, 2 degrees, and it runs right off the field. We had one Saturday recently, rained a little bit. We got ahead and put a blower on them and played in 10 minutes, you know. But other than that, you know, you got your fences, dugouts, and everything the other parks got. But our fields are completely slick. There's no bases. The bases are all painted on. Everything's painted, so you don't have any problem with wheelchairs or crutches or anything like that. If we can find the right people, you corporate people out there that get involved in things like this, we stroke a few checks, we can make that third field happen. We'd sure love to do it. When we start back in the spring, come out, get involved, be a buddy. You know, we got some concession things that you know, they might need help on. And then we have work days and things like that. We've asked some of the parents to they want to be on the board, you know. Well, to be on the board, you got to be involved. You got to be committed to it. We've got a group of 4 or 5 parents that have just been fantastic, and they've been with us. They've taken their jobs and continue to work at them. We've had some ups and downs. You know, as good as this is, surprising, so we'll get a few grumbles here and there. Well, it's not perfect, you know, but we do our level best, and everybody will tell you that, to make it a fun place. And that's what it's all about. Let the kids come out, have fun. Mainstream baseball and all, we know the parents can kind of get in the way of having fun. We like for it to be fun for the kids here. The man is a living, ever-ready bunny. He's the hardest working human I've ever seen in my life. And I call him my hero, not because he's a 100% Marine, but because when you get him involved in something, he's here. He'll be here at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. That's when he gets up. He comes out, and him and another Larry will tidy up the fields. That's why it looks so good. You know, he'll pick up every little piece of paper. He'll set up the drink containers, water coolers for the kids, and set up the microphones and tables, everything. Anything you need done, Marine Mike's there for you. But he is absolutely the backbone of our working force out here. We've got a group of sponsors that have been team sponsors for many, many years. I don't want to start naming them because I'll miss some of them, but the sponsors pay a fee, and that takes care of the shirts and caps, and we're glad to have them. We've got them some lined up. People tell us if you need another one, you know, we'll help sponsor a team. You know, we have a great concession stand. Donna ran it for the year she was alive. A couple of other ladies have taken it over now. They're doing a great job with it. It makes us a little money as it goes along. But, you know, without the sponsors, without some other just donations during the year, you know, we got just like you and I, we got a power bill. We got two of them. We got concession and we got the lights. They put them on separate bills, you know, for that purpose. But we still get a power bill every month, you know, two of them. And you know, there's other little incident things, insurance. You know, we have to pay insurance on the kids. So, and that's, we charge a minimum to play, and that's what it covers. It's strictly for the insurance. We want to get to a point, and I've stressed this is really my goal, get to the point where we got enough in the bank, nobody has to pay. Come by and see us. Look it up on the website, miracleleaguepensacola.org. I promise you, from my heart, if you'll come out and see part of it, you'll want to be part of it, and we'd love to have you. And if you know kids that would qualify, if it's Santa Rosa County, Gulf Breeze, Pensacola, obviously, we have a few that come from Perdita and Mobile. We have got a girl who comes from Mobile. You know, tell them about it. You know, relatives, friends. You see somebody in Walmart. I do it occasionally. I say, do you know about the Miracle League? You know, and surprisingly, some people still don't know about it. We've been here 7 or 8 years, so that's a little disappointing to me. You know, we've had people come over from the neighbor, you know, the NEP and the baseball and the football, and you know, because we played during both seasons, and they come over and ask and look around, and some of them is the first time they've seen it. They'll be back. You know, we had just recently had a couple come over from Perdita that was playing in a tournament. They came over and were just excited. They came back and their son buddied, you know, and you know, if you give it a shot, if you come by and take a look or just walk up to the fence, I promise you, you'll want to get involved. It'll get to your heart. It will.
And now I'd like to turn our attention to the Pensacola Little Theater, as my friend Autumn Beck is going to explain. Pensacola Little Theater has a tremendously rich history, but even a brighter future.
The first time I took my son to see a production, it was Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. And I remember him sitting there kind of with his chops dripping, you know, and wanting to do something like that. But after we left, like, you know, I'm hungry. We have to go, you know, get some chocolate. We ended up going and having a date, just the two of us, at the Melting Pot. And, you know, seeing how every aspect of the theater will then hit on the senses of a child, that he really was hungry for chocolate after watching chocolate on stage for a couple hours. The theater touches lives, adults to children. It touches people emotionally and culturally, and it allows Pensacola to have the Big Five with the professional theater so that we can attract talented people to come work and live here. It was built in 1911, and it was the first courthouse and jail in Escambia County. And for that reason, being on the board, raising money to preserve the historic building is valuable to me. Well, live theater always seems to bring out emotions in people, whether it's watching somebody try to fix what they said that may have been a misstep, and watching that grace under pressure, or just watching the costuming or the musical scores. The Little Theater has all of that. And hearing the various types of stories, we have plays and musicals that attract young people, that make them want to be creative, want to read. We also have shows that talk about very sensitive and important social issues and really bring those things to light. In 1996, they revitalized, the theater moved back here, and now this has been a home for the Pensacola Ballet and for other cultural non-for-profit groups. Well, it gives them confidence, and you know, at the end of the day, when everybody stands up and claps, no matter how well that child thinks that he or she may have performed, they get applause, and you know, most of the time seeing ovations for the little kids. And you know, to have that confidence to get on stage and present themselves well. It also, for me, seeing them up here practicing all the time, perfecting a skill, whether it be dance or music or acting, it shows them the discipline that it takes to have a good product at the end. Nowadays, people who are coming to Pensacola are coming here for the quality of life. If they don't have the quality of life to go see symphonies and ballets and theater, or to have good food at great restaurants, or to have a good nightlife, they are likely to go somewhere else. And when we are really talking about quality of life, and we are talking about attracting that top percent of you know, talent, especially technological talent, they are looking for a well-rounded hometown to raise their families, and theater is integral to that. There, from being a stagehand volunteer, set decoration, to being on the board, to raising money or being a member of the guild, to actually performing, marketing, there are endless opportunities. There's also opportunities for the community to come in and just have a great time with us. Once a year, we do a raffle for a trip. We just finished that last week. We have drinks and food, and it's great entertainment. And then once a year we do our annual fundraiser, which is cabaret. And that is a street party and a party in all of the rooms that are set up with different themes. And it is a great time, and tickets are priced so that anybody in the community can kind of come in and experience the theater in a small dose and in a fun environment. So right now the staff and the cast of The Toad and the Frog are prepping for their opening weekend, and we have set props and we have lighting directors and we have everything kind of in disarray getting ready for that show. And by the time that a patron would come to this theater, everything will be neat and tidy and orderly, but it does take a village, so to speak, to get it that way. The cast, their parents, this is a treehouse production, so there are lots of little children in this one, and their parents volunteer. The Little Theater Board of Trustees is probably, in my opinion, one of the most well-rounded boards in Pensacola. Very strategically put, business people, contractors, lighting experts, lawyers, CPAs, and people who are involved in the arts community on that board so that we can pool our talents. You know, I'm not an actor, but I can raise some money. So we have a very lofty goals for fundraising every year, because the building itself takes a lot of upkeep. We are looking to put a new roof on the building, which will be, thousands of dollars. And luckily, because of the good stewardship of our board, we are one of the not-for-profits that we are not in financial trouble. But it requires ticket sales and tickets to those events. But ticket sales, would be the number one. So people need to come if they really want the theater to stay functioning. Well, if you notice, if you're going beside the theater, we have the banners for the sponsorships for businesses that have have staked their interest in this group. Outside of the theater, there are stars where you can see business owners and people in town who have put their money where their mouth is to show that the theater needs to be sustained. Those stars are, $10,000 for one of those. So that really shows the investment that the local community has put into the theater. The business community uses the theater for special events. The local bar association has their monthly meetings here. People have weddings and events. We have a local business that serves lunch here during the day. And they flock during the day. It's always vibrant. And then with Ballet Pensacola being here, you have a constant inflow of students and parents every day. We have a website as well as a Facebook page, and that has a portal for online ticketing. It has our main stage agenda for the year, our season. This is our 75th season, and it's one of the best. I would say if you have never been to the theater, It's a Wonderful Life is going to be in December, and that's a great opportunity to come and see a show here that will really, get you ready for the holiday season.
Finally, I'd like to close with Cantonment Rotary President Jeremy Evans. My friend is going to talk about the Rotary Club and some of its activities to, again, make the community a better place for all of us.
When I moved here, I have a brother who has Down syndrome, and I have a sister who's autistic. And I lived on 9 Mile Road, and I drove by the Miracle League there on 9 Mile Road one day, and a big sign said Cantonment Rotary was there. It was when they were building it, and it had the thermometers they use as price raising goals. And I thought, that's an organization I'd like to be a part of. A few months later, the company I worked for, one of their mottos and how they like to do business was the four-way test, which was adopted by Rotary. The first time I'd really ever heard about Rotary, and I heard about it within about 3 weeks of each other, two things that were very important to me. And a gentleman I worked with previously had asked me to come to a meeting with him, and that's how I became a part of the Rotary Club here. Internationally, Rotary International, its largest, most all-encompassing goal right now is to eradicate polio from the world. We've been on this plan for about 20 years now, and we've gone from hundreds of countries where there's still polio, and now we're down to four. There is a hope that within the next few years we will have eradicated polio from the earth. We've got a $100 million grant from the Bill Gates Foundation, which became a $200 million grant to help us and assist us in that process. And here locally, apart from helping with the international goals, we're big supporters of the Miracle League, numerous projects around town. Next week, 2 weeks from now, we're sending some people to Costa Rica to help give eyeglasses to poor Costa Ricans who can't afford to have eye care. And so we're sending people to do that. We support the Roy Hyatt Nature Preserve. Roy Hyatt is a former member of ours. The Nature Preserve was named after him, so we do a lot of work out there to help to build that facility so that the students of Escambia County have somewhere to go and actually see nature, learn about nature. Some kids, as strange as it sounds even here, don't see a lot of nature. To take them out into the woods and show them butterflies going from cocoons to butterflies and an experience they don't get anywhere else. We help support and we've sponsored a Rotary Club. It's a college Rotary at University of West Florida. And two things. One, that group is very active in community service and they assist us and we assist them in community service goals. And we also do a lot to develop the, you know, the future leaders, the people that are going to replace me 20 years from now and replace some of the other members of our clubs to continue to develop leadership for the Escambia County area. I want to have a positive impact on what's going on. I don't want to be the guy who reads the paper and shakes my head and doesn't do anything about it. I want to come together with a group of people and be a part of a solution as a part of just the status quo. Recruitment is something that's a part of what being in Rotary is, both by being an example of what we perceive a Rotarian to be. I think that's the biggest recruitment because people are drawn to people who are like that. And they want to be a part of it. So all of our membership growth is coming just from a member inviting somebody to lunch and coming and seeing what we're a part of. We attract a lot of people by the community service projects when we're out in the community, people seeing what we're doing. It's the way I was drawn in, you know, a community service project that the organization was doing. And I saw it, wanted to be a part of it, got invited, became a member. I don't know that the ambition or the future, I mean, I think it's been the same since we started as an organization in 1948 up in the lumber mills, you know, in the north part of the county. Just to continue to do good and develop, you know, leaders and, you know, help people out whenever we can, wherever we can, here in the north part of the county. And now we're joined by past president of Cantonment Rotary Club, Paul Frederick.
Hi.
So Paul, what got you involved in being in the Rotary Club?
Well, for years, when I was at the University of West Florida, our department chair, Bill Griffin, was a member of Rotary, and I see him come back and talk about the things that Rotary is doing. And then Pat Wentz, who was also at the University of West Florida, she invited me to come to a meeting, and that was pretty much all it took, because when I see the good that Rotary does, not only here, but internationally, and nationally as well, and I think we speak a lot about local and international, but sometimes the national gets not ignored, but gets put by the wayside because of the international projects. But following Hurricane Katrina, this club was very heavily involved. And one of the things that we did was restoring the libraries to the schools that were affected by Katrina. And we went out, many members of this club actually went out and delivered books to those libraries that were devastated by the hurricane. And that is an awesome thing to see.
What was the moment? They refer to it as the Rotary moment, the moment that maybe it was before you joined the club or after you joined the club where the light bulb got on and you were like, you know what, I fit in here. This is where I need to be.
I think that was probably following Hurricane Ivan.
Yeah.
When I saw how the club came together and went out into the community and were leaders in the community, and it was just a phenomenal experience to see how Rotary interacted with the community when disaster strikes and how we can come together as a community.
And I think the one thing that has always surprised me is how big Rotary's presence is in Pensacola. We're one of 13 clubs. I believe there's 1,500 Rotarians in those 13 clubs. And the chances are that most people know a Rotarian. They just may not know it yet.
Yeah. One of the things that I think that Jeremy addressed earlier was the four-way test, and that's number one, is it the truth? Number two, is it fair to all concerned? And number three, will it build good friends? And number four, will it be beneficial to all concerned? And I think that thing right there, whenever I want to do anything, I first look to a Rotarian because I know they follow that four-way test. And I think anybody, if you go to a business and you see that Rotary emblem on there, you know what you're going to expect.
I think another thing that gets lost is sometimes even within our own membership, projects may seem small. Not all projects can be eradicating polio from the face of the planet. But here in a few weeks, every year we do a Thanksgiving project where we take a turkey dinner to, you know, what started out as a few families, and it's grown to 20 or so families now. And while in the grand scheme of things it doesn't seem like much, to one group of people it means a ton.
And to one individual it can mean a ton. Case in point, last year when we were delivering the meals, we came upon one house that was very well kept. It was a nice, but it was an older lady who had just got back from the hospital, and there was nothing that could be done, so we were able to give her a Thanksgiving dinner. Another one was that we went to a place and the despair was all over that house, because where the stove should have been was an empty spot. And we went to one of our members and asked if there was anything we could do, because they had no way to prepare Thanksgiving dinner. And that afternoon, one of our members delivered a stove, set it up in that at no cost to the individual, and they were able to have a Thanksgiving dinner.
And I think the last thing is, I believe, maybe this is the optimist in me, most people have the heart of a Rotarian. Most people want to go out and they want to do good in the world. And they're doing it through mission work at their church. They're doing it through doing Relay for Life with the business that they're a part of. And people don't realize that it's an organization of regular people trying to come together to do amazing things.
Exactly. And the one thing I think the common denominator of everybody in this club is they want to take the opportunity to give back to the community. When I have the privilege of doing what we call fireside chats to proposed members, the thing that comes out most in those chats is that they want to give back to the community. And I think that's what Rotary is, giving back.
If you have more interest on an international basis, you can go to learn more about Rotary International, you can go to rotary.org. It's a wonderful website. It's just been brought into the modern ages in the last 6 months. They have completely done an overhaul of the website. It has amazing information that you can learn about how you can be involved in Rotary, from being an eighth grader all the way to being a retired Rotarian, how people can be involved. If you're interested in Cantonment Rotary, we meet at Scenic Hills Country Club every Wednesday at lunch at noon. Guests are always welcome. If you just want to come and see what we're doing, feel free to come by. We would love to have you and meet you. And apart from that, I think that if you know a Rotarian, ask them what they do. Ask them what they're a part of. You'll be amazed to hear the stories that your neighbor can tell you about the good work they're doing in the community, in your nation, and in the world.
I want to thank each and every one of you for taking the time to watch the episode today. As you spend time with your friends and family and loved ones through the holidays, just remember it's in what we give, not in what we get, that we find our joy. Thank you.